Hello, I'm Graham and welcome to the second part of this mini-series where I'm looking at the modern digital camera sensor technology. If you may remember, in part one I asked the question, does size matter? And by size I was referring to the actual physical size of the photosites and not to the size of the sensor itself. You may also recall I stated that the physical size of the photosites contribute directly to the performance of the sensor. Take the example here of a 12 megapixel sensor from a compact digital camera and a 12 megapixel sensor from a Micro Four Thirds system. The digital compact camera has a sensor which is roughly a third of the size of the Micro Four Thirds system. If we look at that in the real world, then although this is the pixel from the compact digital camera, which is a third of the size of the Micro Four Thirds system sensor, the actual area of silicon on the Micro Four Thirds system is actually 9 times bigger than that of the compact digital camera. That gives us a lot more advantages in the fact that the silicon can capture more photons, which can then be converted to electrons, which can be then measured as a charge, which we can use to convert to a digital value used by the camera system. So in answering to that first question, size does matter, very much so. In this video, I'd like to begin by looking at how the digital camera sensor sits within the imaging pipeline between taking the picture and actually storing it on the SDHC card. Let's begin by the component which allows us to actually capture images, and that's light. Light to us means the visible light we can see, and it comes from our sun within the solar system. Light has some very interesting characteristics. One we can measure directly, which is its colour temperature. And the colour temperature is an absolute scale ranging from reds, which are the warmer elements of light, to blues, which are the colder elements. So if you consider a candle flame, which is down at 2500 degrees Kelvin, that is at the warm end of the scale, versus the clear blue sky, which is at the 10,000 degree Kelvin scale, and that is at the colder end of the spectrum. A second quality is the light intensity. And that's the brightness or luminance of the light. And again, we can measure that accurately either using a light meter or by using the camera metering system. But there is another component of light, and that's called the polarization. And light from the sun is unpolarized. It's only when it hits something like water or foliage that the atoms just below the surface of the water or the foliage can actually straighten those light rays out. So instead of the light rays being spiraling and twisting on the way down, when they hit these atoms, they are actually realigned and come out as straight rays. When I mentioned the word polarization, you automatically, I'm sure, thought about polarized lenses or polarizing filters. Well, it's the ability of that polarizing filter to be able to cut that straight wavelength out and give us no reflection. So by angling the polarizing filter, we can cut down those rays that have been straightened for us by the atoms in the water or the leaf. If we look at light in more detail, we understand light is part of a wider electromagnetic spectrum that emits from the sun. We call the part that we can see the visible wavelengths, and they extend from the shorter wavelengths of blue light to the longer wavelengths of red light. The ones which are the shorter wavelengths, blue, emanated around 420 nanometers, and you can see those when you look at a rainbow. They're the inner arch of the rainbow. The longer wavelength of red is around about 700 nanometers, and in the middle we have green light, which is about 550 nanometers. So these three colours, the red, the green and the blue, are fundamental cornerstones in understanding digital camera technology, as you'll see when we look at how the camera actually captures coloured images. The second component in our camera system is the lens. And the lens, of course, is there to gather the light from the subject and focus it down onto the sensor. But it also provides a secondary function of being able to control the amount of light that does hit that sensor by use of the diaphragm or aperture. In some cameras also, like this Micro Four Thirds system and in this compact digital camera, the lens system actually gives us the optical image stabilization. A servo feedback system within the camera controls a floating element within the lens, and that allows that lens to move in respect to any movement of the camera to counter effect any movement to keep the image stable on the sensor itself. Modern camera lenses have highly developed anti-reflection coating on the glass surfaces. Normally, if there's no coating on the glass, when an incident light beam hits the glass surface, about 8% of it can be reflected away from it. So we're losing 8% of the light that's being captured through the lens. If you multiply that by, say, 17 elements in a very sophisticated lens, you end up with only about 50% of the light that started actually reaching the sensor. So it's important that we actually coat the lenses to improve the transmission qualities of each of the glass elements. Actual surface coatings are very, very thin indeed, and they're actually built up in several layers. And it's these layers which are specifically tuned to capture the red, green and blue lights and stop these reflection. So one surface coating can actually be there to provide interference to the blue light, the next layer for capturing the green light, and the next one for capturing red light. So this cuts down the amount of reflections that emanate from the glass and improve the transmission quality of the glass itself. It's a very highly sophisticated process, this vaporization technique to put the coatings on the lens, and that equates to some of the higher quality, higher price lenses. The next component in our pipeline is actually the camera shutter. And its position depends on the type of camera system we're talking about. In the terms of a compact digital camera, the shutter is actually in the lens itself, as I'm showing you in this picture of the lens system from a compact digital camera. The actual shutter itself is just behind this floating element, which is the part of the optical image stabilization circuit. In the Micro Four Thirds system, the shutter is immediately in front of the sensor, but it's normally held open so we can actually use the fact that we're looking at the sensor to provide us a live view image. On a DSLR, the shutter is behind the 45 degree mirror, and it's when the mirror flips up that we actually get access to the shutter. The shutter cycle is a very important cycle within the camera imaging process. In the case of the compact digital camera and the mirrorless camera, when we start the exposure, the first thing that happens is actually the shutter closes. During the time the shutter is closed, the electronics of the camera go to reset the sensor. And resetting the sensor effectively destroys any charge that may be still left on those photodiodes, sets them all back to zero, so we have a black starting point. When the shutter opens, we begin the exposure, and then when the shutter times out, the shutter closes. And once the shutter closes, we can then read out the values of the charges from each of those photosites into the rest of the electronics of the camera, which we'll talk about later. In the compact camera and the Micro Four Thirds system camera, the shutter then reopens so we can resume the live view mode. Obviously with the DSLR, the sequence begins by first of all flipping up the mirror so the light can actually get down to the sensor. The shutter is at that point closed. The exposure begins, the shutter opens, exposure terminates, the shutter closes, and again we can go through the readout circuits for the rest of the camera. So the shutter mechanism is an important feature of the camera. Some cameras possess what's called an electronic shutter, but the electronic shutter is only there once the mechanical shutter is opened, and it's the way that the bits of information are read out from the photosites as to how the electronic shutter works. It acts as a moving, rolling shutter up the actual photosites itself. That brings us to the sensor itself. And the sensor is the most important part of this system. The sensor is built up of an array of these photosites. So in the case of these 12 megapixel sensors, on a 4:3 aspect ratio, we have something like 4,000 photosites horizontally by 3,000 photosites vertically. So the total array gives us 12 megapixels. In fact, the word megapixel is probably the wrong word to use. The terminology, it should be a sensor, or it's the sensing element. A pixel, by definition, is a picture element, and the pixels are normally associated with either viewing or printing, where the actual physical size of the pixel depends on the display or printing device, where a sensor is a fixed element dependent on the size of the sensor divided by the number of individual photosites. So the photodiodes which constitute this 12 megapixel array are built up from a silicon material, and this silicon material has special properties. We're not actually going to go into the deep quantum mechanics of how the photons of light are used to split out of electrons from the diamond cubic structure of the silicon atom, but we will just say that the sensor is there to capture light, and the amount of charge that's captured is equal to the amount or the intensity of light that falls onto that particular photosite. The actual array of photosites, if there was no method of determining what colour of light is striking the photosite, the actual sensor itself would be monochromatic, it would be black and white. And in fact, that's how the first digital cameras were made. They were just an array of photodiodes, and we had a monochromatic output. But now we have the facility to embed onto these sensors a color matrix. And the first color matrix was developed by a Kodak scientist called Bryce Baer, who designed a color algorithm which gives you red, green, and blue filters placed over each of the individual photosites on the array. And they're arranged in a 2x2 repeating pattern that I'm showing you on the screen now. If you look closely at this 2x2 repeating array, you'll see there are exactly twice as many green pixels on the array as there are red and blue. And this is because the idea was to mimic the eye spectral response. The eye is more sensitive to green light, so it was thought by increasing the green sensitivity would actually improve the luminance of the sensor itself. These red, green and blue photosites come together to form the information which tells us what the actual color of the pixel should be. If we only considered red, green and blue, we would have a picture that was built just of red, green and blue, but we need to know what shade that pixel was. So in a real world it might be somewhere between green and blue. We would need to know the exact hue of the pixel that was being recorded. So in real terms, we don't just take one pixel to determine the color. We take it from a 9x9 matrix around a center pixel. And by some matrix algebra, we can actually calculate what the true value of the color would be for the center target pixel. The maths are quite involved, so we're not even going to look at the equation. But if you just take it that the center pixel, which represents that particular center element, its actual color is built from its neighboring 9 pixels. There are a variety of algorithms which will actually help to compute the actual hue of the color that's being targeted on that center pixel. The actual amount of light falling on the photosite will generate a charge on that photosite, and the charge is proportional to the amount of light falling on the cell. The output voltage from this photosite is actually an analog voltage. I know we're talking about a digital camera, but at the stage where light is being captured and recorded, the actual voltage is analog. So we need a method of converting the analog voltage into a digital value that we can manipulate further down the camera process. The actual element which is used to convert the analog voltage from this photosite to a digital value which the camera processor can use is called an analog to digital converter. Now, the analog digital converters, in the case of a camera with a CCD, we just have the one analog to digital converter. And by ways of matrixing the way that the outputs are worked from the CCD sensor, we can stream out the individual pixels one by one into the analog digital converter. And that's why CCD technology sensors are a lot slower than modern CMOS ones. In CMOS technology, we can actually parallel all those outputs into a number of analog to digital converters, and that gives us a complete speed advantage. For example, in video, we need to be reading out at 50 times per second the whole of the sensor, so we need these parallel process signals to enable us to do that. So if we take the CCD, for example, we're just taking one bit at a time, we're looking at the charge that's being captured by that one photosite. We apply that voltage into our analog to digital converter, and that gives us a digital value between black, which would have an output of 0, to full intensity white, which would have a value of 255. So our analog to digital converter converts a voltage from 0 to maximum to a digital value between 0 and 255, or 256 discrete steps. Now we have the actual digital representation of the analog voltage from each of those photosites. This is sometimes called the raw information, or camera raw. It's the basic individual pixel densities from the sensor, which now need to be demosaiced to give us a true camera image. And that's part of the processing giving us a JPEG image. We use what's called a demosaicing algorithm, which then converts all those individual pixels from the array into a JPEG image. There is another type of sensor developed by Foveon which doesn't actually use this Bayer matrix. It uses the properties of silicon which can actually determine which of the color wavelengths of light have actually penetrated the silicon. So in this very simplistic diagram I'm showing on screen now, blue, which is the shortest wavelength, can only penetrate just about 1 micron into the silicon slab. The green light has a lot more energy and it can penetrate a little bit further. and the red being the longest wavelength can penetrate still further into the silicon slab again. So by actually using stack photodiodes in this matrix, we don't need this colour matrix, so it was assumed that by using this facility we would have a better colour rendition than we would with the Bayer matrix. But a lot of more mathematical equations have to come into play, because if you look at this, some of the green or some of the red could actually influence the way the blue channel worked. Beyond our analog digital converter, we have now the central processing unit of the system, and it's the CPU, if you like, that actually converts our digital signals into a readable JPEG, or it's used to work out what the white balance of the scene will be, or it works out what the exposure should be. We need to be able to display what the CCD element is showing, and again we need to take this digital value that's been computed by the central processor and display that on the back of our camera on the LCD screen. And the LCD screen is not a digital display, it's another analog display. So we need to convert the digital values that the camera's processed into an analog value that we can see on the display. So we use what's called a digital to analog converter. And when it comes to displaying the image that the camera's processed from the sensor, we can either have one digital to analog converter, which is matrix from the three channels, the red, green and blue, or we can have three separate digital to analog converters, one for each channel of red, green and blue. If we look at this digital to analog converter in the red channel, for example, if all of those inputs to the digital analog converter were active, it would give us the maximum output from the digital analog converter, and we would see just bright red. The same would appear for green and blue. If all the inputs are set to the highest input level, then we would see the maximum output level. And again, the LCD display is a matrix of red, green, blue LEDs. So the output from the digital analog converter is fed to the LED modules on the LCD display to give us our matrix of red, green, blue to represent the pixel that we saw on the sensor. Also from the central processing unit is the facility to write this color information to a file, either a raw file or to a JPEG image file. When we write the final image to the SDHC card, it's a case of writing an instruction of how to build a JPEG image. If we write the JPEG file, that demosaicing algorithm has already been done for you to create the JPEG file. So in this video I wanted to establish where the sensor fit within the digital imaging processing pipeline. We can now understand how light is gathered by the lens, its intensity is controlled by the aperture. We then have the shutter, which is part of the exposure cycle. So we have a dark reference frame, the exposure begins, the photosites convert the light energy to give us an electrical charge. The electrical charge can then be converted from an analog voltage into a digital value. The digital values can then be manipulated by the central processing unit to either be written to your SDHC card or can be fed through a digital to analog converter to display the information on our LCD screen. So in a nutshell, that's the digital processing pipeline for your digital camera. In the next video, I want to take a closer look at the two types of fabrication, the CCD and the CMOS type, and what are the relative advantages and disadvantages of each of the two types of sensor. For example, we know now that CMOS is a much faster readout than CCD, but does it actually give us a better image? Or is the associated electronics that's involved with a CMOS circuitry, does that add more to the noise over what we get from a CCD circuit? It's been a long video. Thanks for your attention. Thanks very much for watching. And until the next video, please take care and bye for now.